Isaac and his mother lived alone in a small house on a hill. Isaac kept to himself, drawing pictures and playing with his toys as his mom watched Christian broadcasts on the television. Life was simple, and they were both happy. That was until the day Isaac's mom heard a voice from above. Your son has become corrupted by sin. He needs to be saved. I will do my best to save him, my lord, Isaac's mother replied, rushing into Isaac's room, removing all that was evil from his life. Again, the voice called to her. Isaac's soul is still corrupt. He needs to be cut off from all that is evil in this world and confess his sins. I will follow your instructions, Lord. I have faith in thee, Isaac's mother replied, as she locked Isaac in his room, away from the evils of the world. One last time, Isaac's mom heard the voice of God calling to her. You've done as I've asked, but I still question your devotion to me. To prove your faith, I will ask one more thing of you. Yes, Lord, anything, Isaac's mother begged. To prove your love and devotion, I require a sacrifice. Your son, Isaac, will be this sacrifice. Go into his room and end his life as an offering to me to prove you love me above all else. Yes, Lord, she replied, grabbing a butcher's knife from the kitchen. Isaac, watching through a crack in his door, trembled in fear. Scrambling around his room to find a hiding place, he noticed a trapdoor to the basement hidden under his rug. Without hesitation, he flung open the hatch, just as his mother burst through his door and threw himself down into the unknown depths below.
Alright, welcome to the short roguelike mega thread. This is Banning of Isaac. Came out late September, one of my favorite games of the year by far. Now, it's very similar to the old Zelda games thrown in with roguelikes. It's really nothing like it. You got multiple characters you can play. You start with them all locked, and we'll be choosing Isaac for now. Gameplay is pretty straightforward. Move up, down, left, right. Move up, down, left, right with the WASD keys and use the arrow keys to attack. As you can see on the floor there, I actually really like that the entire tutorial is this one room that you start in with all the buttons that you need to know. I really enjoy that there was a roguelike that finally said, hey, you know what, simple can be fun too. I think it was really great and what made one of the things that made this game so successful. But let's get going. First room we come across has a beggar in it. Now these little guys actually are pretty useful, but they're only good for two things, and that's you gotta give them money for it, so that's no good. Right? Now all the dungeons in the game are randomly generated. You can see the map on the top left, marking important things that you found. You can see the slot machine symbol telling us that there was a beggar in the room we just left. Also on the top you have our life bar and things that count, things like bombs, coins, keys, right? What item we have unlocked. Now, this room is pretty tricky. These guys will shoot at you non-stop when they see you, and it can be quite difficult to dodge all those bullets. By peeking around the corner, though, you can angle your shots to catch them, and they won't be able to hit you back. It's kind of boring to watch, because it's kind of finicky, but it's really the only way to get through some of these rooms with the difficult setup. Up above us we see a merchant. We can't get in there because we don't have a key yet, but we'll be back. The room below us with the big skull door is the boss room. You can see on the map it's got the very Zelda-esque boss head symbol. There's no reason we can't go to the boss right now, but each floor has a couple of bonus things on it that, you know, we'd really like to get our hands on before we go further. I had a bomb already, and I figured I might as well use my bomb to get another bomb, because why not? Blowing things up is fun. This is our first mini-boss of the game, but it's really kind of a joke. They kind of throw it in there as a gimme. Golden doors lead to treasure rooms. They always contain an item upgrade of some sort. Here we have Boom, which simply gives us 10 bombs and puts a lovely burning fuse on our head. That's another thing I really love about this game. There is no inventory. You can escape and look at your items, but there's no real inventory as you know it. Instead, they simply change your character icon to represent what items you have. So here we have a supply of bombs, and we have a giant fuse sticking out of our head. It can get pretty interesting when you start stacking effects on top of each other. On each floor, there's a hidden room. Once you've played long enough, you can learn to recognize where these are. Typically, they're found where three rooms meet. Notice how this one has three rooms on each side of it. They either have coins, items, other things in them, but it's a good idea to try to find them on each floor if you can. You can't blow that guy up. I've tried many times. One thing this game does is throw in jokes referencing older video games and also internet subculture. And every now and then, the guy in the special room has the forever alone face, which you can decide for yourself whether that's funny or not. I kind of appreciate it. Piles of poo occasionally contain items. Yes, if you're offended by crude humor, probably leave now, because shooting piles of poo to find gold is about the nicest thing we're going to do in this game. Our little beggar friend, we give him some coins and he gives us items. Here we found a tarot card. Each tarot card has a unique effect. The Hierophant drops out two fate hearts. Fate hearts can increase your hearts over your maximum. You see how I have three regular hearts and two fate hearts at the top now. When my fate hearts are gone, they're gone. Whereas hearts will refill. If you give him enough money, eventually he will give you an HP up item and leave. It is somewhat random, so you could in theory give him a lot, but it doesn't normally take that much before you can get that nice HP up item. Those are really necessary as you play, obviously. And we're on to our first boss. Now, the bosses on the first two levels of the dungeon, called the basement, are not that difficult. Because I have this, I would normally not even use bombs on these guys, but because I found that large supply of bombs in that secret room, I see no reason not to. So, you can take them up pretty quick. Now, these guys move around pretty fast. Nailing them straight on with a bomb is more a matter of luck than anything else, and I did have to take a shot or two as I was fighting these guys, but with those fate hearts, I don't think I took any actual health damage. Their body segments are weaker than their head segments, and if you can nail their body, you will do about double damage to them, so that's always useful. When you kill the bosses, they always drop some health refills. They drop a special item of some sort. It's typically a health up, and they open the door to the next level of the dungeon. Here we have spoiled milk for breakfast, which ups our HP again, giving us 5 hearts. You can see our progress in the game so far along the top of the screen, as well as Isaac's little delusions of grandeur. Now, these enemies on the bottom are probably some of the more annoying enemies. They actively try to dodge your bullets. You can see him running between my shots there like a little idiot bitch. They can be pretty hard to hit, but they don't have very much life, and they're really no danger. They're just an annoyance. Here we have our first item upgrade. Now we actually have something to use with our spacebar. Spacebar items are rechargeable. You will use them when you finish a number of rooms, they become unlockable. This Scroll of the Dead will randomly use one of any other item type. So here, we actually have the Book of Belial effect from the Scroll of the Dead. The Book of Belial makes you look incredibly evil and do very, very large amounts of damage with your tears. To the right, we have the arcade. Arcades are very useful. They contain multiple special things. You have a slot machine, which is pretty standard, a guy playing three-card Monty at the bottom, and a blood bank. Blood banks will take half a heart of health each time you use them and give you money for it. They can be good if you're looking to buy anything from the shop. Also, if you use enough hearts on the heart bank, they will give you the blood bag. The blood bag increases your HP up, and it refills all of your health and makes you look terrifying. I really love the way you look with the blood bag. Notice on the walls back there, there's pictures of Super Meat Boy and Yet It Moves, other games from indie developers. Not sure if it's the same indie developer or not, but... You see, I lost 3-card Monty, and that shall not stand. Yes, but all the machines in the arcade can be blown up, and you can get bonus goodies from them. This is a battle room down here. You need full health to enter the battle room. You can't enter it if you're missing any. But we are at full health, so we can go in. There will be a treasure in the middle. Once you grab the treasure, enemies start spawning in. You have to fight 3 waves of enemies before the doors open up again, so sometimes it's not really even worth it. These hornets are actually one of the more difficult enemies you can face, because you start out surrounded, and it's quite difficult to evade all of those shots without taking too much damage. These rooms are mostly dangerous just because they're big and they're open, and it's easy for enemies to surround you in them, and so that's what makes these rooms tough more than anything else, but most of the time they're not too big of an issue. Pills have random effects each game, similar to other roguelikes where potions are randomized. In this game, pills are randomized. There's a set number of pill effects, and each game you'll only get some of them. For instance, I believe there's 20 pill effects and only 7 pill types. So in each game, you'll have access to some of the pills, and you don't know what they'll do until you use them. Generally, I just hold on to them, just for an emergency in case they're good, but just as likely, I will get down to 1 HP and hope for a full health refill, only to get bad gas and die. Looking for that secret room, and we found it again. Again, those appear where in... Those are the question marks on the map, and they appear in the middle of other rooms, so they're pretty easy to spot. Later on, as the floors get bigger and bigger, it'll be more and more difficult to find those rooms, but for right now, it's not that bad. I love the little headless bodies here as they wander around aimlessly. Not dangerous at all, but they really kind of crack me up. Yeah, this is one of those games. I mean, you're playing a naked baby running around in a dungeon. I don't know what you really expected. And again, trying to shoot around the rock to hit the guy to avoid getting shot. Playing roguelikes for years has made me very, very cautious most of the time. Now, in shops, you see the item costs on the ground. Again, very, very reminiscent of Zelda, right? The good items always cost 15 coins. Items in red are half off. And so that key, for instance, is half off. I see this pill down beneath me, and I want that pill. So I used the pill that I had to find that my tears went down, and that's rate of fire. So my rate of fire dropped because I used those pills, but, well, I might as well pick up the other pills. Maybe they'll be good. I don't think they will be. This is a type of enemy you don't see very often. They're not dangerous at all, and kind of pointless, really. I think the developer might have wanted to do something more with them, because they're really unlike any other enemy in the game, and they're not dangerous. They don't really do much. And here, I use the Scrolls of the Dead again, only to get one big bomb underneath me, which accomplishes nothing. This boss is one of the easier bosses in the game. Whenever he breathes out, he summons those flies, which will circle him as a shield. When he does a big breath, he will knock all the flies away from him, and they will start chasing you down. Mostly, he's just annoying, because it can be difficult to shoot through that fly shield, but you notice that he doesn't have very much health, and he takes quite a bit of damage from your shots. He's more tedious than anything else. On the other hand, I love the way he looks. He always reminds me of the sandworms from Dune.
You know, if they had anuses for eyes.
If you can beat the dungeon without getting hit, if you can beat the boss and beat the dungeon without getting hit, you stand a higher chance of getting good rewards from the boss itself. So trying to avoid damage is more than just survival, it's actually gives you better items. And that's it for the dungeon. You see, I unlocked Monstrous Tooth. As you play through the game, you'll accomplish different tasks and you'll unlock new characters. Magdalene you unlock for getting 7 heart containers in one playthrough, and Monstrous Tooth you unlock for clearing the basement. That door up above me is the Devil's Door. It's made more likely for it to spawn if you have not taken damage during the boss fight. You get the Yum Heart for discovering the Devil for the first time. The Devil is a shop, and how it works is you get those items at the permanent cost of health. So this one right below me is going to permanently take 1 heart container from me, but it will give me that item. The one in blue needs Faith Hearts. And in order to get that one, you would have to have Faith Hearts. I don't have any, and so we will continue down to the next level of the dungeon, and I will catch you later.